Our next speaker is a Benedictine nun who's been dubbed many things: Europe's most radical nun, the radical Catalan nun on a mission, and simply described as hard to keep up with. Well, we found her. She's here. Please welcome Sister Teresa Forcades. Thank you.
Haven't you got this microphone?
So, good afternoon to all of you. We are here gathered in the wake of the Synod of Bishops, and I would like to start my contribution to help us think critically about the situation of women in the Church, sisters, women in general, and in the situation of the Church in general, because what affects sisters and affects women affects us all in the Church and beyond. I would like to start by quoting some other synod that happened many years ago, actually a few centuries ago, but that you'll see why I'm quoting that to begin with. That's the Synod of the Lateran Synod, the third one. The third Lateran Synod happened in 1179, and that was the synod where it was decided that the abbesses of monasteries would no longer, which means they used to do it, would no longer forgive the sins of the nuns. Here, the nuns in confession. That means the abbesses were doing it, and in 1179, that was forbidden. After that came, after the third Lateran Synod, or Council actually, it came the fourth Lateran Council, and the fourth Lateran Council in 1215 moved a bit farther and said not only the abbesses, it reaffirmed what the third Lateran Council had said about the prohibition of the abbesses to forgive sins, but it said the abbesses and all the nuns of the monastery are demanded, they have to confess with a priest once a year. So we see those two synods moving in the direction of disempowering women in the Church and making them submissive, directly dependent of the ordained men. But what I wanted to say is to go a bit farther, because 70 years later, we encounter a woman of the Church, actually today called a saint of the Church. She is Gertrud of Helfta. She lived after these two synods. Actually, the second council that I have mentioned is 1215, and Gertrud was born in 1250s. So after that, this nun, this Benedictine or Cistercian, there is controversy, I don't go into that, but this certainly monastic nun of the 13th century lived, and she had some revelations of God. And I would like, that's why I'm carrying the computer, which I will leave alone in a moment, but because I want to read the words that this sister of us, this woman of the past, wrote in the 13th century and that have come to us, so that you hear what her experience was. Here is what Gertrud said. By your grace, and she means by the grace of God, not by the grace of the bishop, by your grace I acquired the certitude that all those who, wishing to have access to your sacrament, restrain themselves because of the fear of a burdened consciousness, if they seek humbly to be strengthened by me, by Gertrud, the smallest of your servants, on account of their humility, your unlimited tenderness will judge them worthy of your sacrament, and they will truly receive the fruits of eternal life. And you added that if your justice did not allow somebody to be justified, you will not allow that one to humble her or himself seeking my counsel. That Gertrud wrote, they will truly receive the fruits of eternal life. So binds Saint Gertrud of Helfta the most sacred and heavenly gifts with her own actions on earth, the actions of Gertrud. And she does so explicitly in no ambiguous terms. Here we hear again the voice of our sister from the 13th century. You, God, Jesus, you also certified to me, most unworthy, that all those who wish, who with penitent heart and humbled spirit come to me seeking counsel about their faults, according to the degree my word, according to the degree my word declares their faults, according to the degree my word declares their faults to be more or less serious, thus will you, God of mercy, judge them more or less guilty or innocent, and that by your grace they will henceforth obtain your help, so that their defect will not impinge on them as dangerously as before. Dom Pierre d'Oyer, Benedictine monk of the Abbey of St. Paul de Viscas, translator and editor of the works of Gertrude in not the 13th century, but the end of the 20th century, that's 1968, the translator and editor of Gertrude, Dom Pierre, deemed it necessary to introduce a footnote right after these bold affirmations of Gertrude, a footnote in order to clarify that the nun had not been granted by God any kind, and that's quote, any kind of sacramental role, but the gifts of enlightenment and persuasion to help a fearful consciousness come to terms with the problems of guilt and forgiveness. I have some technical limitations here.
No problem. I can hold it for you.
Long, but
okay.
Then, was Dom Pierre right? Did the nun Gertrude, honored up to today as one of the greatest saints of the church, and by the way, the patroness of the Benedictine novitiates all over the world, did the nun Gertrude receive the sacramental power of granting the absolution of sins, or did she not? Gertrude herself seems to have believed with no shade of a doubt that such divine favor had been granted to her. And now comes my third quote for Gertrude. Thirdly, said Gertrude, the abundant liberality of your grace enriched the poverty of my merits with the certainty that whenever I, trusting in the divine piety, promised somebody the forgiveness of a crime, your benign love would consider this promise, according to my word, as solid as if you yourself had in truth sworn it with your blessed mouth. Those are the words of our fourth sister, and that's what she seemed to believe about herself, and that seems to be also what the many pilgrims who sought her advice also believed, because there are testimonies of the time that say many people used quite often to ask Gertrude's advice on certain doubtful points, and in particular, whether they should, for one reason or another, refrain from receiving communion. She would advise those who seemed reasonably fit and ready to approach the Lord's sacrament with confidence, and as God is gracious and merciful, and sometimes she almost forced them to receive the communion. And touching the tongue of the saint, the Lord said, that means touching the tongue of Gertrude, the Lord said, hereby I put my words in your mouth, and I confirm with my truth all the words that you, inspired by my spirit, will utter to anyone from me, and all that you promise on earth on account of my goodness will be granted in heaven. That's my introduction to raise the following question. We have this council, or these two councils, the Lateran councils of the 12th and 13th century, making a conclusion and determining what in the church is going to be allowed or not, as the councils should do. And we have, 70 years later, a saint that the same church has proclaimed as a saint, given what I have wanted to read to you directly because I think it's not doubtful testimony of having been granted precisely that power, that sacramental power that the Church a few years before had made forbidden. That's, of course, an interesting question for how do we believe in the 13th century and today, how do we believe that the Holy Spirit acts in the Church? Is that seems to be that maybe the Holy Spirit does not act in the Church only through the official pronouncements of the Church. It seems that it might be possible that the Church utters an official pronouncement that is not sustained by the Holy Spirit, and that it might be possible that somebody who is not part of this official pronouncement in the Church, of course also outside, but I'm talking in the Church, is being sustained by that very Holy Spirit, without which the mission of the Church ceases to have any meaning among us. Gertrude of Helfta is one of many women, the memory of whom the Church has preserved up to today. We're going to celebrate her feast in November. 2 days ago, we celebrated the feast of St. Teresa of Lisieux. In a few days, St. Teresa of Avila. Last month, St. Hildegard, St. Clara of Assisi, Mary Magdalene, and Blandina, and Hilda von Bidby, and so many, hundreds of women who the Church remembers, and remembers in an honorable way. Remembers what these women did, remember what these women wrote, remember what these women initiated socially, the social initiatives of these women. This actually, I must say, and it's important for my argument, this is not what is usually happening in our society. I come from the background of science, and I have studied medicine. I did my graduation in medicine in 1990. I had heard about something called, of course I studied, not heard, I studied in depth, something called the Watson and Crick model. And what that is the model for how our genetic material, our DNA, is structured. And this Watson is actually James Watson, and the Crick is Francis Crick. Those are two men. And I studied in the 80s medicine, and I was told that Watson and Crick did the discovery of the structure of the DNA. I had no clue at that time that there was a woman who was the initiator of that discovery, and a woman who not only was the initiator, but she did all the research necessary to build up the discovery. That woman was Rosalind Franklin, and that woman died in 1958 from ovarian cancer at the age of 39 years old. The science in 30 years has completely forgotten her, has not passed on the memory of that woman, let alone her writing, let alone her private life, her inner life, and what she dreamt of, and with whom she was in relationship with. The Church, on the other hand, is this institution that we are here to raise our voice, to criticize as a patriarchal institution, and I am have done that in the past, and I'm coming here to stand also to reinforce this accusation, this denunciation that our Church is a patriarchal structure and that this is urgent to change it, that we cannot, the Church cannot give witness in the world of the Holy Spirit without addressing urgently and in the most radical way this issue. But I also want to make the point that the Church, this very same institution, is the one that has been able to preserve, as I said, the memory, the words, the social initiatives of the women of the past. And that, to my experience, has not happened in science, has not happened in the humanities, where many times contributions of women of the past, even women, as I said, 30 years ago, even women of the 20th century, let alone women of the 16th or the 14th, as all feminist historians are historians of science and historians of art know very well. This has not been the case in our society. And I want to add something here, because my argument is being, in the Church, we do have a treasure. In the Church, we have something precious that makes us more responsible. That we women in the Church, bishops in the Church, men in the Church, every one of us in the Church is in a position to make a statement, to make a move forward for what it means to live differently, men and women, because unfortunately, the inequality between men and women is not only a problem of the Church. And it's not overcome either in our society, even though, and I celebrate that, of course, the laws of our society don't discriminate the women. We don't have laws that discriminate, but you all have heard about the so-called crystal ceiling. You all have heard about the experiences of women where the discrimination today is present. You all know about these young women that feel such a pressure of conforming to certain images of beauty for women that are dying actually at a young age because they force themselves into bodies that are impossible to achieve. All the events that go surrounding this, all what it means for women today. So that what I wanted to emphasize is, Joanne Kelly in the 80s already wrote something that it remains until today an uncomfortable reflection that she did. And the reflection that she did was the following. During the time of this Christian European, the Christendom, the church dominating this European society, there was, of course, a society so-called theocentric, that at the center placed God. And the highest achievement of human being in that society was called sainthood. Sainthood was the greatest ideal, what was more prestigious. It's what was not being a bishop or being a priest, but being a saint. This ideal, and I'm following here this scholar, Joanne Kelly from the 80s, this ideal of sainthood was open to women. And not only was open to women, but it seemed to be achieved by women even in greater numbers than men, and that's why up to today there is these dispositions in the canon of the liturgy that say, well, when you say a litany you cannot say more names of women than men. That happened to me when I did my profession. Actually, I wanted to have the litany of the saints only with women because I thought that's a symbol, right? And I'm a woman, of course I love men saints and men in the church and outside the church, but okay, that's a symbol. I'd go with the litanies, and we just will hear Saint so-and-so, Saint so-and-so, all names of women. And they said, no, that's forbidden. You cannot do that. And I said, but could you have a litany only with men? Yes, that's possible. It's not forced to put women there. So again, what I'm saying is this, trying to convey what of a strength we have in our church, but of course within a context of making it problematic from the beginning. But I move on. Joanne Kelly says the society where the church was dominating was placing in front of everybody an ideal of human attainment, perfection, and fulfillment that was open to men and women. The society of humanism that comes after that, and that we all celebrate, and I celebrate the moving forward from this regime of theocracy, it was a society that made this known turn, the anthropocentrism, in the center. Now we have this anthropos, and this very society moved away from the idea of sainthood into an idea of intellectuality, the use of reason as being that becomes linked to the human dignity. When the society moves into the human reason as being that's linked to human dignity, the prestige of monasteries and religious societies and churches also is displaced, and the university comes into the center of the fulfilled human life. And now, oh surprise, women are forbidden to go to the university. We have now, for the first time, in comparison with this medieval time, we have now a social idea that points towards a fulfillment that it is forbidden, officially forbidden for women. How that has played into the consciousness of inferiority of women, how that, as you very well know, from the beginning was being contested, all this querelle de femmes, that is a discussion that occupies the intellectuality of the 15th, 14th, Christine de Pizan until the 17th century. It is many centuries of battle trying to overcome this discrimination. But as you also well know, this higher education doesn't come until the 19th century in many instances, and this continues until today, at least in my country, and as far as I know in many others, happening that at the university, today we have more students that are women than men. At the professors, we don't have more women than men. At the main professors or heads of department, we don't have more women than men, and at the top positions, we don't have more women than men. So it continues until today, this difference and this discrimination of women within the greater academia. So that we have, for us, who are sisters and women and also men, priests and brothers in the church, for us who are in the church, we have a situation which is not, and I, at least my situation is not, one of feeling I belong to an institution, the Roman Catholic Church, that is behind a society that has moved so much forward that we are, have become anachronic, and that we need to catch up and just run this stretch that is separating us from the good equality that the society has achieved. But actually, we do have in the church a treasure. We have something to give witness to. We have a story, and we have the elements that would help us to help the society to move towards an ideal of true and deeper equality. And of course, at the same time, we have anachronistically a structure that is giving the impression of completely the contrary. We have a structure that is telling the world by its very existence that we are behind in the issue of women, that it's not helping to make visible how these monasteries, religious communities, and also all the lay women that are around these communities, what they have achieved, what they have done in the past and today, what they are doing in the realm of social justice, but also in the realm of feminine subjectivity, how much an inspiring figure for so many women that reality can be. This is all being met, being made like nothing by comparison and structure that officially and in explicit ways discards the contribution of women. This has been already said this morning. We've heard Sister Campbell talking about the vote. We've heard also Sister Madeleine talking about the homily, and we've heard Sister and Prioress Irene talking about the sacramentality. All those are reivindications are that I am in agreement with, and all those I think it's urgent that the church sets the sight to achieve. And above all, there is one, which is the one that we are here together to talk about, this capacity of voting. This, the other ones, they have happened in the past. I have talked about Gertrude of Helfta and the sacramentality. We could talk about Hildegard and many others and the homily. But this idea of voting, that is together with our modern society. The voting, even though the rule of Benedict already says decisions are to be made listening to everybody, but one thing is to listen to everybody, another is to make this action, this right to vote. So this action and this right to vote, I'm here also to stand to call our church into the responsibility, not to catch up with an outside society only, but for above everything, to be coherent with its own history and with its own call to let the Holy Spirit be active among us.